Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English. This is what you will hear on today's program. Anna Mateo has a story about a plan from environmental scientists to prevent plants and animals from disappearing. Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins have a story about how heat and pollution threaten India's garbage pickers. John Russell explains some words that go well with the Olympics. Then, Andrew and Jill return to talk about the passive voice. But first, here's Anna.
A recent report by environmental researchers says that protecting 1.2% of the Earth's land surface could prevent most extinctions. Extinction is the permanent disappearance of an animal or plant from the Earth. The researchers estimated that such an expansion of nature preserves would cost about $263 billion. In 2022, United Nations delegates to the COP15 meeting in Montreal, Canada, promised to protect 30% of the Earth's surface by 2030. The UN calls the promise the 30 by 30 target. It aims to protect plants and animals severely affected by climate change, pollution, and habitat destruction. In October, UN delegates will gather for a COP16 biodiversity meeting in Colombia to discuss plans for reaching the 30 by 30 goal. The recent study was published in Frontiers in Science. In it, the researchers aimed to identify the highest value areas around the world. Carlos Perez said he hopes the areas identified will be included in protection plans. Perez was a co-writer of the study and is a conservation ecology expert at the University of East Anglia in Britain. Perez said most countries do not actually have a strategy. He said the 30 by 30 targets still lack a lot of details because it doesn't actually say what 30% should be protected. The study's proposed protections would cover an additional 1.6 million square kilometers. This is an area about one-fifth the size of the United States. The study includes 16,825 sites that are home to rare and threatened wildlife. It is estimated that nearly 16% of the world's surface already has some level of protection. The study estimated that the cost of purchasing land by governments would be about $263 billion. Many of these areas include private property and would be bought at current market values over the next 5 years. Time is not on our side, Perez said, because it will become increasingly more expensive and more difficult to set aside additional protected areas. Most of the cost of creating protected areas is in buying the land. The study did not consider the costs for policing and maintaining the nature preserves. About 3/4 of the sites are tropical forests. The Philippines, Brazil, and Indonesia are home to more than half of the high-valued areas. Russia is the one country with the most high-valued areas. The study said about 138,000 square kilometers should be the target of conservation. Several African countries are also at the top of the list. Madagascar has the fourth highest number of areas. And the Democratic Republic of Congo has the largest area targeted for conservation in Africa. The United States is among the top 30 countries in the study. The study said about 0.6% of the U.S. should be targeted for conservation. That is an area about the size of the state of Delaware. The researchers only considered land and freshwater areas. They did not consider oceans or marine protected areas. The study also did not include kinds of animals such as invertebrates or animals without a backbone, like insects. The U.S.-based nonprofit group One Earth paid for the study. I'm Ana Mateo.
Near Jammu, India, the smell of burning garbage or waste material spreads out 4 kilometers across the city. The site where the garbage is burned holds a mix of plastic, industrial, and medical waste. Experts say the air is dangerous to breathe. The extremely high summer temperatures add to the danger. But a small number of people work at the site through the smoke and intense heat. They search the garbage before it goes into the fire. They collect anything that might be sellable. They earn at most $4 a day. If we don't do this, we don't get any food to eat, said 65-year-old Usman Sheikh. We try to take a break for a few minutes when it gets too hot, but mostly we just continue till we can't. Sheikh and his family are among as many as 4 million garbage pickers around India. The job is dangerous, and increasing summer heat brings even greater risk to the workers. In Jammu, a northern city, temperatures this summer have climbed above 43 degrees Celsius often.
As waste breaks down, it creates heat. Summer temperatures intensify this heating. As a result, the landfill releases more gases such as methane and carbon dioxide. These gases are dangerous to breathe. Experts say the summer landfill fires can burn for days. India's federal government estimates the country produces about 56 million metric tons of waste each year. A 2016 law requires dangerous material to be separated from landfills, but enforcement of the law has been weak. This adds to the risk the landfill workers face. Bharati Chaturvedi is founder of the New Delhi-based Chintan Environmental Research and Action Group. She has worked with waste pickers for more than 20 years. She noted that the workers already face health risks from direct contact with the waste. The extreme heat is an additional danger. It's been a terrible, terrible, terrible year, she said. They already expect to suffer from the heat, and that gives them a lot of anxiety, because they don't know if they'll make it, if they'll survive it. Heat stroke, cardiovascular diseases, and chronic kidney diseases are some of the risks from working outdoors during high heat.
Ruksana Begum is a 41-year-old waste picker at the Balswa landfill in the city of New Delhi. She said some waste pickers are working less because of the heat. As a result, they only have enough money for one meal a day. They are trying to avoid work because of the heat, since if they go to work, they end up spending more at the hospital than for their food, Begum said. Chaturvedi said it is necessary to give the workers water, shade, or a cooled building to use near the landfill. She said they should be urged to work less when the temperatures are high. And she said medical care must be available to the workers when they need it. Geeta Devi is a 55-year-old garbage picker. She also works at the Balswa landfill in New Delhi. Devi says when the heat makes her dizzy, she takes shelter. Sometimes someone gives her water or food. But she has no choice about working at the garbage site. She earns about $2 a day. That's what she needs to feed her children. It is difficult to do my job because of the heat. But I have no other job, she said. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
The Paris Olympic Games will begin later this month, with the opening ceremony set to take place on July 26th. You are likely to see and hear discussions about the Olympic Games, the athletes, the events, and the results of the competitions. For today's lesson, we will explore this question. What are three important words to know when we talk about the Olympics? There are many possible answers, but we are going to take a close look at these three words: host, compete, and expect. The Olympic Games are held every 2 years and take place over 2 to 3 weeks. Thousands of athletes take part. Thousands of workers, volunteers, and others prepare for and run the event. Millions of people from around the world gather at the Olympic Games to watch the athletes perform. Cities around the world request to hold these huge events. They seek to host the Games. Or we can say that cities seek to be the host of the Games. The word host can act as a noun or as a verb. When we talk about the Olympic Games, we use host, the noun, to mean the city that holds the event.
Paris is the host of the 2024 Olympic Games.
The verb form of host means to receive and serve guests.
Paris is hosting the 2024 Olympic Games.
Note that the verb form of host takes a direct object. Direct objects often answer the question, what?
Paris is hosting what? Paris is hosting the 2024 Olympic Games.
So, we have the noun, host, and the verb, host. Which of the two is more commonly used, you might ask? Google's Ngram Viewer has data that comes from thousands of books. We can look at how common different words are and see how the usage numbers have changed over time. We should keep in mind that the data and results are not perfect. Still, we can take away general ideas that can help us. When we compare the noun and verb forms of host in Google's Ngram Viewer, we find that the noun form is more commonly used. And what is the most commonly used word after the noun host? It is the short word of. Let's think back to our earlier example.
Paris is the host of the 2024 Olympic Games.
Our next important word is at the center of Olympic Games action. Compete. Compete is a verb. It means to try to win something that someone else is also trying to win. We might use the verb compete to describe the athlete's purpose for going to the Olympics. So we might say this.
The athletes are competing for a medal.
Note that we often use the verb compete without an object. In other words, we often use it in an intransitive sense. For example, we might say,
7 athletes are competing today.
Still, we often use the verb compete with other short words. Google's Ngram Viewer suggests that with is the most commonly used word after compete. So you are likely to hear or see something like this.
Athletes go to the Olympic Games to compete with other top athletes.
However, we can find other short words commonly used after compete, such as for, in, and against. You might hear, athletes are competing for gold medals. That athlete is competing in the 100-meter dash, or the athletes are competing against each other. Overall, the main idea is that the verb compete is central to discussions about the Olympics. Compete may be followed by a short word. With is the most common of these short words, but you should probably learn the other common short words as well, for, in, and against. Our final important word is expect. It is used to express our predictions. People might expect an athlete to do well. They watch the Olympic Games to see if the expectation is correct. This is part of what makes the Olympic Games exciting, and partly explains why people enjoy talking about the Olympic Games. We have expect, a verb, and a related noun form, expectation. Google Ngram Viewer suggests expect is more commonly used than expectation. We often use the verb expect with an object. In other words, in a transitive sense. The object could be a noun or noun phrase, as in,
the trainers expect hard work.
Or we might see a structure that acts like a noun or noun phrase in a sentence. The structure 2+verb is one such structure, as in,
the swimmer expects to win.
Or we might use a more complex structure like this.
Fans expect that runner to win gold.
Today we explored a few words that connect to the Olympic Games. Of course, there are many other choices. We will end this lesson with a call to action. write to us a short description of an Olympic Games, either in the past, present, or future. Be sure to use some of the words we have explored today. Send your writing in an email to learningenglish@voanews.com. In a future lesson, we will give feedback on some of the messages that we receive. I'm John Russell.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
And now, the lesson of the day.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Today's lesson helps you do more with Level 2 of our video series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Today's lesson is about an important grammar topic, the passive voice. But it is also about a kind of American food called barbecue.
And barbecue can be an important topic for some Americans, as we will see in Lesson 8 of Level 2.
But first, here's a quick example and explanation of the passive voice. Listen to these two sentences.
My brother broke the glass. The glass was broken.
The first sentence tells us who did the action. My brother is the subject who did the action.
The object of the verb broke in the first sentence is the word glass. And in the second sentence, the glass was broken, we either don't know or don't want to say who did the action. We care more about the glass. So, the word glass becomes the subject, and we use the verb be plus the past participle of the verb to show that something happened to the glass.
The passive voice is often used when we want to put extra attention or focus on products or things, such as food, rather than the people who make or produce the things.
Now, let's listen to part of Lesson 8. Anna does a news report on the subject of barbecue. Try to listen for sentences with the passive voice.
Today, a barbecue battle is being held in Washington, D.C. This festival, which is known as one of the biggest food festivals in the United States, brings together barbecue lovers from all over the country. Barbecue is meat that is cooked over an open fire or on a grill.
Chicken, pork, and beef are all common meats to grill on a barbecue.
No matter which meat you like to barbecue, the sauce is very important.
Sauces are taken very seriously by chefs. Most ingredients are kept secret.
So, can you tell us what is in your barbecue sauce?
No, I can't tell you.
So tell us, what is the secret ingredient in your barbecue sauce? Sauces are made by the barbecue chefs themselves. Most sauces are made with a tomato sauce, vinegar, and spices.
Did you hear the definition of barbecue there? It's
barbecue is meat that is cooked over an open fire or on a grill.
It doesn't matter who is doing the cooking, so the passive voice is used. You can also hear the passive voice in the last two sentences. The word sauces is more important
then who makes them? So Anna uses the passive voice.
Sauces are made by the barbecue chefs themselves. Most sauces are made with a tomato sauce, vinegar, and spices.
Listen to Professor Bott give another example.
How many passive sentences did you find? Here is one I found.
Today, a barbecue battle is being held in Washington, D.C.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. We often use the passive when there are large numbers or statistics because there are so many subjects doing the action.
For example, we might say that millions of smartphones have been sold during the last 10 years. In this example, we don't know or care about the people who sold them. We want to bring the listener's attention more to the phones than the people who sell them or who buy them.
Now we're going to learn more about barbecue in the United States. Different regions or areas in the U.S. cook the barbecue and make the sauces in different ways. And there is some friendly competition between the regions about who has the best barbecue. That's why there is a festival called the Barbecue Battle. Let's listen.
There are some areas of the U.S. that are known for their tasty barbecue. The states of Texas, North and South Carolina, and the cities of Memphis and Kansas City are known as the Barbecue Belt. People who are loyal to barbecue are really loyal to their favorite barbecue. That is why this festival is called a battle. Let's ask a couple of people which barbecue is best.
Texas, of course.
Carolina barbecue is the very best.
Kansas City, Memphis style.
Kansas City.
Texas.
Kansas.
Texas.
Kansas.
Texas.
Kansas.
This
Texas.
Is Anna Mateo reporting.
Texas.
She keeps saying Texas, I said Kansas.
You can see that people disagree about where the best barbecue comes from. Jill, what about you? Do you have a favorite type of barbecue?
I like the sweet sauces like those from Texas. How about you, Andrew?
Well, because I grew up mostly in North Carolina, I have to say that I enjoy North Carolina barbecue the most. The sauce there is not really sweet, but instead it has some vinegar, which makes it have a special taste.
Just like everything from North Carolina. After going to the barbecue festival, Anna shows Kelly her report. Let's see what Kelly has to say about the subject.
Kelly, people feel so strongly about barbecue. Unbelievable. So, what do you think of my project?
This is what I think. There is no way that Texas has the best barbecue. I am from Kansas City, and we have the best barbecue in the whole country. My mother and father owned a barbecue restaurant, which was really famous. So I know barbecue. Anna, I know barbecue. I know barbecue. I know barbecue.
Oh my, Kelly knows a lot about barbecue, and you know more about passive sentences. Be sure you go to the website to learn even more. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm hungry.
It seems that Kelly also had some strong feelings about barbecue. And now I think I'm getting hungry too.
Yeah, it's almost lunchtime. And as Professor Bott says, remember that you can learn more on our website at learningenglish.voanews.com. Each lesson of Let's Learn English has a lesson plan you can download for free. It explains more about the lesson and has helpful information for both students and teachers.
Remember that you can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. And thanks for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
And that's our program for today.
Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.